Savior. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. As we worship together this morning, I'm going to invite you to have a seat and listen to our multicultural ensemble as they share a song that is lifted straight out of the text from Timothy when Paul is writing to his young mentee in the faith. Paul is mentoring this young man, Timothy, and he is exhorting him to be faithful in the ministry of the word. And that exhortation is not only for those who might be in the pastorate, but that exhortation is for all believers, because we are all called to be a witness, to testify of what God has done in our life and what he has come to do in this world through his Son, Jesus Christ. So this exhortation is for you this morning to preach the word through the conduct of our life, through the words of our mouth, through the thoughts and actions of our life, to preach the word. Would you bow your heads and let's pray together. Father, we come before you this morning in awe of your majesty and in awe and in humility that as you hold the world in your hand, you also are mindful of man. Not only are you mindful of him, but God, you desire to have intimate relationship with him, with us. And to that end, Lord, you have overcome the barrier of our own rebellion, of our own fallen nature. You have overcome it through the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. And it is by virtue of his sacrifice that we come into your presence boldly this morning, praising you and thanking you. God, would you enable us through your Spirit to live a life of wholeness, of right relationship with you and with our fellow man, with our brothers and sisters, no matter the social barriers that might exist, the demographic differences, the regional differences, the economic differences, the racial differences. God, may we come together as brothers and sisters in Christ at level ground at the foot of the cross. We love you, Lord. May you be honored and glorified in the remainder of this worship time together. May you speak to us through your word. Give us heart and ears to listen. And I pray this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen.
Let's continue to worship this morning as we listen to God's word, taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16 through 20. Because of this decision, we don't evaluate people by what they have or how they look. We looked at the Messiah that way once and got it all wrong, as you know. We certainly don't look at him that way anymore. Now, we look inside, and what we see is that anyone united with the Messiah gets a fresh start, is created new. The old life is gone. A new life is flourishing. Look at it. All this comes from the God who settled the relationship between us and him, and then called us to settle our relationships with each other. God put the world squared with himself through the Messiah, giving the world a fresh start by offering forgiveness of sins. God has given us the task of telling everyone what he is doing. We are Christ's representatives. God uses us to persuade men and women to drop their differences and enter into God's work of making things right between them. We're speaking for Christ himself now. Become friends with God. He's already friends with you. May the Lord bless the reading of his word in our lives this morning.
Thank you, Joyce, focusing us this morning on our scriptural text. And now I invite you to continue to listen. What a joy it's been to have the 3L Cultural Intelligence Group with us this week. They started with us for a number of us who were at the National Center for Civil and Human Rights on Saturday for a full day kind of experience. They descended here on Monday. They were with us yesterday. They broke into your table fellowship yesterday at lunch. That was cool. And then we had a great town hall experience last night. We're exploring an important topic here in our midst. How can we, in all of our diversity, this diversity that makes up TFC, who we are, how can we embody the kind of life that is at the heart of the gospel together? And the 3L Cultural Intelligence Group has come and helped us begin to envision what that looks like. And so today I'm excited to have the founder of 3L Cultural Intelligence Group, Reginald Screen, to come and to share this message from 2 Corinthians chapter 5 as we continue this exploration together. I invite you to listen, and I invite you to respond to what God is going to say in and through the message of his word today. Let's give Dr. Reggie Screen a welcome to TFC. I'll get it for you.
Good morning. Where's Officer Kearse? Where is he? Come up, would you please, and stand with me. He's going to do my introduction piece. But before he does, I want to give this little story. I heard Jeff, Drs. Philpott and Walls did a great job yesterday, so I figured it would be appropriate for me to start off with the story. I need a timekeeper. You're the man? What you have? Okay, there you are. Put me at 20 minutes. Raise your hand. All right. 20 minutes. So the preacher's at the door of the church, and he's shaking hands with the congregation as he's leaving. And 7-year-old little Billy is next in line. He says, "Good morning, Billy. How are you doing?" Reaching out his hand to shake the little boy's hand, he feels something pressed in his palm. He looked at it, and it was a dollar bill. He asked, "What's this, Billy?" Billy says, "Money, and it's for you." He said, "I don't want your money, son. I don't need your money." He said, "Oh, yeah, you need it. I want you to have it." "Why do you want me to have it, Billy?" And Billy says, "Well, my daddy says you're the poorest preacher we've ever had, and I want to help you out." Well, I hope that I'm not going to be the poorest preacher that you ever had, and so you won't have to be giving me dollar bills. Amen. So would you, I'm going to pray for us, and then would you tell a little bit about your story as a police officer? And I normally give an introduction on some of the things that brought me lament and almost pushed me out of evangelical Christianity. So he's going to do it for me instead. But let's pray. Father, thank you in Jesus' name. Lord, I remember the old song that I heard growing up. Oh, Lord, I'm asking you one more time to strengthen me where I'm weak and build me up where I'm torn down. Father, I ask you to let the words of our hearts and the words of our mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength, our rock, and our redeemer. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Thank you, Reggie. Appreciate it. I just want to thank all of you guys for being so attentive. And I thought yesterday was phenomenal. Our time at lunch was phenomenal, being able to sit down with you guys. This campus is ready for these conversations, and that was definitely evident at the town hall last night, where some of you guys, I think, heard where I come from. I haven't always been a police officer, but I remember after graduating from a Christian college about like this, getting a job in my field, dream job, but I was sitting in my apartment at the time. I was engaged, and I remember seeing the unrest in Ferguson after Michael Brown had died. And my world being flipped upside down by the idea that not everyone thinks police are the good guys. I come from a law enforcement family. My father was a police officer. My grandfather was a police officer. And it just blew my mind that not everyone thinks police officers are the heroes. And so I was at a little bit of a turning point in my life where my heart was broken. And I think as Christians, that's how we find our calling. Is we find what breaks our heart, and then we wear ourselves out trying to fix it. That's how you find your calling right there. And so I had that broken heart for an entire marginalized people group, and I thought, well, I can fix it. And that's how we find our calling. And so what I knew in my heart was that whether it be Michael Brown or Tamir Rice or Eric Garner or Philando Castile or Sandra Bland, that I don't know whether they're guilty or innocent, but I know that they weren't deserving of death without due process in America. And that's what I knew in my heart. And I knew that as a Christian, I'm called to grieve with the grieving and come alongside of them and love on them and fix the injustice. We have to fix the injustice. We cannot turn a blind eye to injustice as Christians. And so I was compelled out of my love for Christ to radically change my life and sign up to be a police officer as a 140-pound white guy. I thought there's no way they're gonna hire me. And they did. And I truly believe I have the best job in the world. And what's been absolutely amazing is as I've pursued this and figured this out and learned every single day, because as we do anything, we have to have the spirit of teachability. We have to know that we're never gonna know all of it. And as we talked last night, we're gonna make mistakes and we're gonna have uncomfortable conversations. But as we do that, God is going to bring powerful, powerful people alongside of us to join with us in that ministry, in that fight, and that's the body of Christ. And so as I've gotten to know Dr. Screen here, I've realized that this is God bringing together his body of Christ with similar broken hearts to fight a similar injustice. So I'm so excited for you to hear what he has to say, because he's operating out of the same broken heart that I work with every day. Thank you so much for your time. It's been awesome to get to know you guys.
Thank you. Give him a hand. And so he had one reaction to the deaths that were happening, and I had quite another. Because I work in the South Atlantic District, and I'm the only piece of pepper at the table most of the time. Now, you know what I mean by piece of pepper, right? It's a euphemism for a black guy, right? So everything else is salt. And so who would I talk with? How could I approach them? And unbeknownst to me, that every death, everything I saw on the TV with these guys dying, it was doing something in me. And I remember trying to talk to people about it. I talked with one guy about it, and he said, "Oh, Reg, don't worry about it." This is a white Christian brother. He said, "Once you find out," I think it was Michael Brown. He said, once the due process takes its place in terms of investigation, you will find out that he deserved to die." And I just said, "Excuse me?" And I tried to talk to another brother, and it was the same thing. And then after the verdict came in, my brothers were kind of in a corner over there in the gym, and they were laughing about it. And they said, "Hey, Reg, if you ever get to see a cop and they stop you, don't duck your head, because you might get you." That was too much for me. What would I do? So I said to myself, I tried to talk to people in the upper echelons of the faith, and nobody really had anything to say about it. So I just said, "I'm out. I'm checking out of evangelicalism, because it doesn't honor people who look like me." And one day before I checked out totally, I thought about an old guy named Dr. John Perkins. And Dr. John Perkins helped me understand, really, 2 Corinthians here, 5:16-20. Now, I read it in the Message Bible, and I put it in the Message Bible because I want you to understand that reconciliation is just not vertical, it's horizontal. And it captured it the best. But I want to just quote here four things that the ESV, NIV, ASV, King James Version says about this passage. It says that we've been given a ministry of reconciliation, right? I like to think a ministry is taking what God gives me and give it to someone else. It says that we have been given the word of reconciliation. Now you say, "Well, yeah, reconciliation is in my heart, but it needs to be in our mouths as well." And then he says we've been given what I call the heart of reconciliation, or the attitude of reconciliation. You know, the Bible mentions heart 2,300 times, heart/spirit. Sometimes it uses those two words interchangeably, but it doesn't give a description, but it has a definition, but it has a description. It says basically it's deep underlying character traits, attitudes, and motivation. Deep underlying character traits, attitudes, and motivation. So it gives us the heart, or the attitude of reconciliation. Then it gives us the title of reconciliation, called ambassador. I want to talk to you about the heart of reconciliation. How much time do I have? 12 minutes. Okay. All right. I kind of push it in 3 minutes there, so we're good. So if we're going, here's my big idea. If we're going to be effective at living out this ministry of reconciliation mandate, we must have the heart of a reconciler. If we're going to be effective in living out this ministry of reconciliation mandate, we must have the heart of the reconciler. What is the heart of the reconciler? It says in the ESV, not imputing people's transgressions against them. Not imputing people's transgressions against them. So the reason why it's so hard to come together, because I find out what's wrong with you, and you find out what's wrong with me, and we camp on those two things, right? And so the heart of a reconciler is people who are able to see other people as God sees them and respond to them as God responds to them, no matter who they are, no matter what they've done. And so I went to see Dr. John Perkins there, and he taught me three things that I want to give to you that established me and allowed me to recover my heart
as a reconciler. Everybody still out there, wave your hand so I can see you. That's good there. Pay attention to me because, again, this is really important. Because life is lived at the heart level. You understand that, right? And so I grabbed my 10-year-old daughter. I jumped in the car. I drove to Jackson, Mississippi. How many of you guys from Mississippi in here? Okay. Yeah. It's tough. It's tough in Mississippi. So I got to Jackson, Mississippi. And Dr. John Perkins is an 87-year-old black evangelical. 87, sorry. I didn't know he was still alive when I called. You know, I said, is Dr. Perkins still alive? He said, yes, he is. I said, is he still coherent? He said, yes, he is. I would like to establish an appointment with him. So I got up there. Here comes this spry 87-year-old guy about 8 o'clock at night. And he sits down. And he said, hey, Dr. Street, I read over your bio and all the information about you. Why are you here to see me? I said, Dr. Perkins, I'm here to see you because you have something I need. Then I began to tell him the story of what it's like to try to be a person of color in a white evangelical world and how I was frustrated and I was ready to check out. And so he listened for about an hour, and then he stopped and he leaned forward. He said, Dr. Screen, do you know why I have been able to be effective in ministering cross cultures? Because if anybody should have been able to check out of evangelicalism, Dr. John Perkins should have. He saw his brother get murdered cold-blooded in line when he came back from the war just for not giving his spot to a white guy at the movies. So if anybody should have checked out, he should. So I was there because he had walked the walk. He said, I'll tell you why I've been able to be effective. He says, because I'm not angry. And then something akin to a bomb went off of me and said, something said, but you are. You see, unbeknownst to me, everything I saw when I saw Eric Gahn and Michael Brown, and I think Sandra Bland took the cake for me, and Tamir Rice, when I saw all of that stuff happening, and so for many of you might even struggle with the name. I remember I was preaching at a church about this, and the guy said I loved it until he went political. Because what he had taken the names of those human beings, those people, and he had put it with a particular political ideology that had been presented. But they are people, make no bones about it. They are somebody's sons and daughter. And so he said, I'm not angry. And then the scripture came up to me that be angry and sin not. For the wrath of man does not work the righteousness of God. So I had to deal with my anger. So that was about 11 o'clock at night. I was ready to go. I felt like go to bed. I felt like a ton of weight had been lifted off of me. So I went to bed. Got up next morning, bright and early. Dr. Perkins comes in. He says, hey, my friends and I were talking about you last night. I'm thinking like 87. We went to bed about 11:30 or 12. When did you have time to talk to your friends? But nonetheless, I didn't get into it. And he says, I got something else to tell you. He says, when I was, if this was in the 70s, he was registering people to vote in Mississippi. And he said that they lured some of his workers into another county because they knew he would come and get them. Now, I think this is the 70s, right? So that's not that long ago. And when he came to get them, they beat him, they arrested him, and they beat him all day and all night. Most of his intestines are missing. He said they would beat him, they bludgeoned his skull, his skull was open. He said that when he would come to, they would make him get the mop and mop up his own blood. And when his wife came, he said, if you don't get me out of here in the morning, I'll be dead by in the morning. And he said, and one time when they were kicking him and beating him, he said, if I had an atomic hand grenade, I would pull the plug and I would kill us all. He said, why are these maggots beating up on these poor people like us? And he said, something hit him and said, wow, your reaction is just as bad and even worse than their actions. And he thought about his own need for the grace of God. And the quote, he quoted John Bradford's statement, "There but for the grace of God go I. There but for the grace of God go I." And so I heard something that said, or someone said, the need to be humble, because if maybe what would I be if I were in that situation? That was Martin Luther King said that the doctrine of black supremacy is just as evil as the doctrine of white supremacy. Suppose it was the other way around. Would I be the one giving out the beating? So the second lesson I learned after be angry and sin not was the need to be humble, because you never know what you could do if you were in another situation in another setting. Are you guys still out there? Wave your hand. Let me see you. All right. You're still there? Now, he taught me one more lesson. What do I got? How much time, brother? 4.5. Man, I'm surprising myself. The third lesson he taught me, and the last was, because we're talking about what it takes to recover, to have a heart of a reconciler. See, you can have the message, and you can have the ministry, but if you don't have the heart, this is a moot point. I wanted, and I was trying to get this ministry established for years and years and years and years, but I couldn't get it done because I was angry, and I didn't know it, and I was not as humble as I should have been. And so it never could fly. But when I left Jackson, Mississippi, things started to happen because I had entered into that place of a heart of a reconciler. So he said the last thing here is that he taught me, was the last point, is that, see, I was ready to get out of Jackson, Mississippi, and my 11-year-old daughter, 10-year-old daughter was too. She was kind of looking at me cross-eyed, you know, and side, head to the side like, "Dad, we've not lost anything in Jackson, Mississippi." Jackson, Mississippi is like 20 years behind, I'll just leave it there. And so I was ready to go. I had my bags. I was going outside, and I saw a truck out there that said Jackson Utilities or something like that, or Jackson Water, and there was a guy sitting in the truck. And he had this smug look on his face, and I went ahead and put my bags in the car, and I was walking back, and I was looking at him again, and he just had that smug look on his face. And I said, "I know that look. I know where I know that look from." You see, he was about 27, 30 years old, and he was on Dr. Perkins' place, and he was like, he was a white guy. He was like, "I own this place." You know, he had that kind of attitude. And I had seen that thing 1,000 times because I grew up in southwest Georgia in a place called Bainbridge, Georgia, and I had seen that happen on my grandfather's farm 1,000 times. Oh, where was the message of be angry and sin not? I lost that. It was gone. I didn't even know there was such a message. In humility, that was out the door. I was incensed. I was like, how can he come up at 30 years old and this guy is 87 years old and giving his life and he's riding up on his property like he owns the place? And so about that time, Dr. Perkins came out and he looked at me and he looked at the dude and he looked at me and he said, "That boy didn't learn a thing." And looked at the dude and then he said, "Hi, I'm Dr. John Perkins. This is my place. How can I help you?" I just went on in the house, and I talked with John's daughters for about 30 minutes, and I came out, and it looked like that those two were best friends. How did it go from that great divide to best friends almost? And then when the guy pulled on off, Dr. John Perkins pulled me to the side. He said, "Young man, listen, anybody could love those who love them. How do you love somebody that does not love you? How do you love somebody that doesn't respect you?" He says, "Listen, the last thing I want to teach you is that you have to learn to affirm the dignity of all people, even when they're not acting dignified." I said, "Okay, yeah, I got it. I was ready to go." I said, "Yeah, we need to give dignity to all people." I was, "Oh, no. He got angry, right? He said, "No, you don't give anybody dignity, because if you could give it to them, you can take it away." He said, "You can only affirm that which God has given." Now, you look around you, I don't care whether somebody's black, white, man, woman, whatever they are, that they are made in the image of God, the Imago Dei, and we're called to affirm that. And we're called to fight against a system that will rig or even give a picture of who God is that's not what the Bible says, and give a picture of who man is that's not what the Bible says. Then we used to play a game and we say, I declare war. And that should be our stance. What we got, brother? Zero, so that means I got 3 minutes. And so, I declare war. Some of us are so Democrat, so Republican, so Tea Party, so Green Party, so independent that you wear a cape around you of that rather than the cape of a Christian cape of who you are in Christ. And so some of us have believed the message that or what mom and has said and dad has said and granddad has said or whatever about other people that don't look like you, and you carry that as your mantle when you need to lay that down at the foot of the cross. You see, you know, in the Bible, there's a story of Joshua and the captain of the Lord's army. Have you read that story before? And Joshua's mama didn't raise any dummy, so he saw this towering figure that was there, and he ran up to this guy and said, "Let me help me understand who are you and whose side are you on? Because if you're on our side, I know we win, but if you're on the other side, I know we lose." The guy basically said this in Screen's interpretation of, "You are thoroughly confused, Joshua. I am the captain of the Lord's army. I'm neither on your side or their side. I didn't come to take sides. I came to take over." You see, if we are called to have a heart of reconciliation and affirm the dignity of all people, no matter what someone else have they possibly taught us. My grandfather taught me, he was born in 1909. He saw some horrendous things. Lynchings and the whole nine yards. And his worldview was, son, you can never trust a white person. Because that was his experience. So what would I do with that? What should I do with that? Somebody tell me. Now let me try this group right here. That group right there, they don't say much. What should I do with that? What should I do with that? What should I do with that? Let me see that, what you have right there in your hand. Bring it up here. I take it and test it by scripture. And then if it doesn't line up, I'll make it bow to the word of God. For this is the plumb line. This is the only truth. This is the only rule. We are to come under the authority of the word and not so much what we've been taught at home. I think if we're going to be able to make a dent in this whole deal of reconciliation, we're going to have to make culture bow to the cross instead of trying to make the cross bow to culture. So are you willing to look at the situation and be angry and sin not? Are you willing to practice humility? There go I, say, by the grace of God. And are you willing to affirm the dignity of every human being, no matter what they look like? If you are, you're ready to don the garment of a reconciler. Because you will have the heart of a reconciler. Father, thank you for the word today. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. And so we stand with you, Lord. Oh, Lord, I'm asking you one more time to strengthen us where we're weak and build us up where we've been torn down. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand and let's sing this hymn together?
church today? Sing the choruses if you remember them.
Oh, church, arise and put your armor on. Hear the call of Christ our captain. For now the weak can say that they are strong. In the strength that God has given, we shield of faith and belt of truth. We'll stand against the devil's lies. An army bold, whose battle cry is love, reaching out to those in darkness. Our call to war, to love the captive soul, but to rage against the captor. And with the sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor. When faced with trials on every side, we know the outcome is secure. And Christ will have the prize for which he died, an inheritance of nations. Arise, shine. Foes lie crushed beneath his feet, for the conqueror has risen. And as the sun is rolled away, and Christ emerges from the grave, this victory march continues till the day. Every eye and heart shall see him. Sing, Spirit. So Spirit, come, strengthen every stride, give grace for every hurdle, that we may run with faith to win the prize of a servant good and faithful. As saints of old stood on the way, returning triumphs of His grace, we hear their calls. Hunger for the day when with Christ we stand in glory. Arise, shine, for your light has come. Arise, shine, for your risen sun. Lift your eyes, we are His.
Seek to respond to what God's been saying to us over these last many days. We learned a hashtag yesterday, right? What does it look like for us to inhabit the third space? That third space is kingdom space. Not Democrat, not Republican, but kingdom space. That's what it is that we're seeking to inhabit here at TFC as a community. And so as we go from this place today, here's the response. Yes, to ask God to continue to do a work in your own heart and in your own life that enables you to inhabit that space. But how about this? How about we begin to respond to the message this week? That as we walk from this place, as we gather to eat lunch together, as we gather in our classes, as we gather for our Barnabas groups tomorrow, as we gather in the Coffee Odyssey House on Friday night to listen to each other's stories, how about we begin by saying, what's it like for you to be a student here at TFC? I want to listen to what that's like for you. And then I want to share with you what that's like for me. And maybe as we begin to share our stories, as we begin to inhabit this third space, maybe we'll begin to see life through each other's perspectives. And as we do, to get an idea of what the kingdom perspective might be like for us. And so how do you respond this morning? By actually engaging each other in the kind of open relationships that bespeak the gospel. See, let's not just proclaim it, let's display it in our relationships one with another. As you go from this place, let's respond to God today by giving ourselves to that kind of life together. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, go in His grace and peace.